You can develop an end-to-end solution in a Salesforce using just a configuration, right? But still, there are some areas which is something based on the client requirement. We have to go for a customization. Customization means which is something you cannot do in a point or a click and drag area, which is you have to go for a little bit of coding. So in Salesforce, they are using a language called Apex, right? So the Apex is something which is developed on the basis of object-oriented programming. Okay, so if you have a good understanding of OOPS concepts, for example, like what is class, what is loops, if loop, for loop, and conditioning, that is what for loops and all comes into picture. Then instances, function methods or functions, you can call it as anything. Methods of function overloading, constructors, objects. So these are the some of the few OOPS concept which is people are using in the Apex. Nothing much. Unlike a Python or Java or any other a vast programming language, you don't need to worry a lot about Apex. If you, once you started working on Apex, you will find it quite easier, especially the people who are already worked in programming languages like Java, they will find it easier. Okay, fine. This is it, Apex. Okay. So today, in today's class, we're going to see very basics about the Apex. Let's see one by one. We'll see about what is Apex and Apex classes. Then we will see about collections in Apex class. Then search languages. Just what is what, nothing much. It's a very basic class we are going to have today. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, if you anybody have any doubt, you can stop me then and there. You don't need to just watch and wait for the question time to raise your question. You can stop me then and there, unmute yourself, stop me then and there and ask your question. If you find any difficulty, put it in the chat. Okay. Okay. So let me log into my developer org. Okay. So generally, if I ask you, okay, go to account, create a new account, what you will do? You will go directly into application or app, this app launcher. You will find an account here. Yes, account is here. So if I ask you to create a new account, what you will do? You will click on this button, new. Okay. So what is happening at the back end? When you click on the button new, the Salesforce is understood, okay, this guy is going to enter some data in the account object. So immediately what it will do, it will allocate some spaces for all the fields in the account at the back end. So you can enter your value here. I showed account and rest of the fields if you want to enter and click on save. The moment you click on save, at the back end, what would happen, right? It will do all the order of precedence steps. For example, if you have a validation rule, the validation rule go and check. If you have process builder, the process builder will check, is there any process is happening? And if you have workflow, it will check. So similarly, there are 12 to 13 operations at the back end will happen only after that. If nothing is there, then only the account will get inserted. So the account will insert like this. This is something you will be doing in a just a point, click and drag. That's it. In a configuration way, you have done this. Okay. Suppose if I ask you to create an account in a customized way, let's see how we can do that. So for that, you have to go for developer console. So developer console is the area. So where you will be playing around with the classes and all. You will develop all your stuff only here. Let me. So what you see is the coding area and is the play area for the developers. You have basic navigation menus and you have other menus here. I will explain for what purpose we can use these menus and how it will help the developers to develop the code. Okay. So first, let's start with the debug menu. If you go to debug, go to open execute anonymous window. As the name itself mentioned, it is an anonymous window. So here you can write your Apex code, a basic code. But whatever the code you are gonna write here, right? That will not be changed, sorry, that will not be saved anywhere. You cannot use that code for any future purpose. This is just an area where you can write a code and test for yourself. Okay. So as I mentioned earlier, let's see how we can create an account using a code. Okay. So further, you want to mention the object API name. So account is an object. So what is the API name for account? What is the API name? This is applicable for all the custom object and the standard object. Let's go to the object.
I think only account will be common.
Yes. If you look at the API name is only
account.
All right. Yeah. Suppose if you have any custom objects with you, any guess how the API name would be?
It will end with double underscore C.
Right. You got it right. So the API name is the key here. We have to wherever you go and do your scripting, if it is whether it is a field, whether it is going to be a custom metadata or it is going to be an object, you have to mention the API name. It should not be the label. So that's the thumb rule. You should keep it in your mind whenever writing the Apex code. Okay. Cool. So we have, if it is a custom object, the API name with the underscore underscore C. And if it is a standard object, as mentioned, it is going to be a only account. So now we are going to use only account. So first start with the API name, account. Okay. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to give an instance for this account, AC. You can keep this instance as any name. You can have some random name. It can be anything. Okay. Just for a understanding purpose, I keep it as AC. And this is also very important as a coding best practices. Even if you are declaring a single variable, make sure you are giving a proper name. And if you are writing any code, make sure you are annotate that. Annotation means you should mention for what purpose you are doing this code and all. Okay. So I'm creating an instance equal to new account. Simple. So this piece of line, what it will do is it will just do a steps what we have done for the new account. Like, let me show you. So when you click at the new, right? This is what we are doing here. When you click at new, we are doing that in the single line. Fine. Next, what you will do after you click at new, you will give the input for the fields, isn't it? So let's see how we can give the input. So AC dot. So now I want to give an input for account name. So let's go and see what is the AP name for name, account name. Go to account, go to fields. What is the AP name here? Field name, it is just a name. And for account number, it is just an account number. If you have any custom field, then the custom field will have an underscore underscore C. Okay. So I need a name. I'm going to give a name. Name is nothing but Apex online test. So make sure you're giving between the strings, sorry, single quotes. Then similarly, I'm going to give one more input, which is account number, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That's it. So we have given the field input. Okay. Once you give the input, what you will do next? You will click on save, right? So here, not save. You are going to do insert. Insert AC. Why AC? Because AC is the instance here for the account. So wherever AC is here, it represent account. Okay. So now let's see whether so if you want to execute this piece of code, you have execute button. Execute highlighted means nothing, but if you have plenty of code, if you select any particular piece of code and click on execute highlighter, it will execute only that one. If you click on just an execute, it will execute the entire code. Make sure you have open log so that the log will open and you can see. Execute. It is executing. Okay. So this is the log. See what is happening at the back end when you insert just a piece of code. It will do all the things. It will do a heap allocate. It will allocate the bytes and all. If you look at the timing, it isn't all microseconds. All the script is happening within the microseconds. See, the moment at the microsecond of 4, a DML option, DML is beginning. DML is nothing but your insert, update, delete, which is called the DML. So when you insert in a record, what is happening? First is go and check the validation rule. What are the validation rules? Okay, whether this guy going to insert anything against the validation rule, it will check. If it is not happening, then it's check the duplicates. If there is no duplicate, then the workflow get fired. If there is no workflow, then the trigger. So whenever you do an DML operation, all this backend automations will go and check whether is there anything that this piece of code going to alter. If it is nothing, then only it will get saved in the database. So in our case, we haven't touched any validation rule, any automation. Let's go and see whether the record is inserted or not. Go to account and see the record is inserted. Apex online test. Look at the detail. We have the account name and we have account number as well. So all that what we have done, we are just even enter the only four line of code. This four lines of code helps you to insert the data into the Salesforce. Okay, so for any doubt, guys, any questions you want to ask, because this is the very, very first step you have to do when you start your coding part in your Salesforce. Even you can try this code on your own. At the end of this session, I will be sharing the recorded video session of this one. So you need not to note anything else. Even a reference link also, I will be sharing with you in the WhatsApp group where you are. So just listen carefully. No need to note down anything. Because at the end of the session, as I mentioned, I will be giving you the recorded video session. Okay. Just listen and
ask. Ashok, one small doubt.
Yes.
So this, I mean, this window we opened, only the code is remaining anonymous, right? We can still alter the live data.
Yeah, you can alter the live data.
So only it's not like a sandbox.
This window is, the window is anonymous.
Okay, so only the code remains anonymous and it's not like a sandbox. So do we have a sandbox option or something like that?
See, sandbox option means you want this code to be saved somewhere and you want to reuse it. Is that your question?
No. Sandbox in the sense I want to check the code, but I don't want to disturb the live data. Just to see if my code is correct. And then if everything is perfect, then I'll apply it to the live data. That's how.
Okay. See, what you are seeing here is it's a sandbox. This okay. Kind of is available for all the sandbox. I mean, for all the Salesforce org, we call it as an org or environment, this developer console option would be there. Okay. So you can do and alter whatever you want in your sandbox, even for your production org, that live org, for that also, this anonymous window will be there. If you want to alter your production data, you can do it directly using it. That is
yeah, but without altering production data, will I be able to check the code?
Yes, you can able to check the code in your sandbox.
Okay.
Any doubts, guys? Any other doubts?
Yeah,
yes, sir. Yes, go ahead.
Just we see that log, right? The first itself, it will verify the DM. If we have any DML operation, it will go for DML operation, then verify the validation tool, and then next to go for the duplicate records, then it will validate for the workflow, and then we'll go for trigger, right?
Correct.
The flow for this is the flow for entire insert or update, whatever the DML option.
Yes. That is a part called order of precedence. Order of precedence means in Salesforce you have many things, right? Like validation rule, duplicate, process builder, workflow, and the triggers and everything. So Salesforce has defined a term like how the DML operation should be taken and what is the order of precedence should happen. So what you are seeing in the left is an order of precedence.
Okay.
So first it will go and hit the validation rule, then before trigger validate. I will share you what is the order of precedence it is following in the Salesforce. If you take any languages or any programming thing, they will be having their own order of precedence. Yes, mm-hmm. Salesforce also have the same. It is common for all the operations. It is not only for insert, only for update. It is common for all operations.
Okay.
Anything else?
Sir, hello.
Yes.
Sir, in this code you are inserting an account number, right?
Right.
So where I can confirm whether this account number is inserted or not?
That's what I have shown you, right? You can go ahead and check it in the account. See, this is the account number we have inserted.
Okay.
You can directly go ahead and check it in the account. Okay. Any other doubt?
Venkatesh here. I have one more doubt. For an individual in the mari nama 1 or 2 accounts create pandradhukku, we can just do it manually.
Correct.
Okay, so vandha nama or large amount of data nama insert, we can create a header and header and nama indha or template create panni panna mudiyuma, or else we have to do all the things manually? Yeah,
that's a very good question, Venkat. So let's see. I thought of doing that quite later, but let's say we can try to do it now. Okay, let me. So your question is whether we can able to do it for the large amount of data. Okay, actually that we plan to cover that in the collections. Just to hold on this, Venkat, let me complete this Apex class. We will come to that part, that doing the bulk insert and update. Okay.
No problem.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so if you look at right here, right, as I mentioned here, this is an anonymous window. You cannot reuse this piece of code for any later use. And what you are doing is we are hard coding the value. We are not sending the value as a dynamic. So let's copy this code. In order to reuse the code for the future purpose, and if you want to use that in any programming language, create it as a class. So go to file. Click on new, click on Apex class. Your name, you can give any name you want. Online class Apex. Okay. We don't need it now because we have a class here. That's it. The moment you put it here, right, it will open. So now what do we need? We want our piece of code to be here. So we have put our code. If you ask me, Ashok, whether this piece of code now, how we can execute, you cannot execute it directly. What you have to do is, you have to put this piece of code within a method or function, we call it as. So public void account insert. What I'm doing is I'm just creating a method, a function we can call it as. This is the name, this is a user defined name. You can give any name, that is not a matter. This is not a keyword or something. This is the just a name giving for the method. As I mentioned earlier, whatever the name you're going to give, that should make some sense for this piece of code. So that later point of time, if any developers comes and see your code, they should also be understood for what purpose this is being created. And this is public, okay? We call it as an access modifiers. Access modifier means you have public, you have private, you have protected. These are the modifiers currently are available in the Salesforce. If it is public, as the name mentioned, it will be this piece of code can be accessible by anybody within the org. Similarly, private means only the piece of code only can able to do that. Protected means it will be in the protected mode. So see, as I mentioned, this is a very basic class. I'm not going into deeper for anything. So if you have any doubts on even any single keyword or single word, you just ask me, okay, so that we can give you the clarification. So we have access modifier. Suppose if I ask you whether I can create a class or a method without access modifier, yes, you can still do that. It will automatically take it as a public. So we have put it as a void. What is void? Void, it is a return type. So whenever you are defining a method, okay, that should have the syntax in that way. Like your access modifier, it should have your access modifier, then return type, then method name, braces, that's it. This is the syntax you are going to follow for your method or function. Suppose if you are going to pass any parameters, you can pass the parameters here within the braces. So what you are seeing is that, so we have access modifier, return type, method name, and braces. We are not passing anything here, and single quote. Within that function, we are putting this piece of code. The return type is void because we are not going to return anything. Void means no return type. Suppose if you're going to return anything, what is going to, what I'm going to return? Return means you can return anything. You can return a string, or you can return an integer, or you can even return an account and as an object. Why I need to return, if you ask, right? It will depends upon your, how to say, the requirement. After run the piece of code, what should happen? After run the piece of code, what should this piece of code should return to you? That's what. I will explain you. Suppose if you have a confusion on the return type, I will demo a few things and you will understand all. If you look at here, right? So I have a class and I have a method. Within a method, I put my piece of code. Let's save it. If you look at the star symbol, it means you have made something changes, but you haven't saved it. So Control S, save the record. It will get saved. Now the star symbol is no longer appear. Now, let's execute this class. In order to execute the class and in order to call the method, what is the, see, now the class is online class Apex. Put the class name. You cannot directly use the class name. So what you have to do is just create an instance for this OCA. It can be any instance. Okay, this is a user defined. So create an instance for this class. We are going to create a new instance. So new online class. That's it. It means we are going to take we can create one more thread or one more instance. So within the class, what we are going to use, we are going to call my method. Okay. So that's it. Now, if you execute this script, what will happen, it will create an instance for the class. After the instance, it will call this method. If you, once you call this method, it will execute the piece of line, whatever given within this. Let's try this. We already have online test demo, right? Online test within method. Let's try this. So now this is going to insert a new account for yourself. Click on execute. Same, the log will open. Okay, the log will open. Now go and check your account. See, a new account is created with the name we have given. So what all that you have done is you just call the class and you call the method. So whenever you call the method, it will execute. As I mentioned earlier, it is not written anything. Okay, so I put it as void. Suppose if you want to return anything, say for example, if you want to return the record ID or something, put this as a return type as ID. Return ac.id. AC here represent account, right? So what I'm going to return is the one which inserted now. Whenever you insert an account, what will happen? An ID will get created automatically. It is applicable for all the objects. Whenever you create a new records for all the objects, it will create a unique identifier for an object called a record ID. So I want to return that record ID. Let me save it. Okay. So since it's going to return something which is an ID, let me put it in a system.debug. System.debug is something will help you to check what is coming through the code. See, this is also user defined. You don't need to give like this. Why you are giving hashtag? Why you are giving this name? I'm just giving, as I mentioned, I'm giving a proper code. And whatever you are doing here within the system debug, it will execute. So I'm just going to check the account ID is whether creating or not if this particular piece of code is being called. Okay. Let me check. The log will open. In that log, you have a debug only option. Click that one. See, it means account is inserted, and that once the account is inserted, that account returns some ID. If I go and check for this ID, just replace this and check for the ID. It is there or not? Check. It's there. Yeah, it should be view. Okay. See, for that particular piece of ID, if you look at the ID created UJAAI, it is UJAAI, it created an account. But this piece of code, it not only created an account, but also what it did, returned an ID. Similarly, even if you want to return the entire account, you can return it. All that what you have to do, return AC. Put the return type as account. You can return anything. You can return a string. You can return an integer. You can return like anything. I'm returning account now. Let me rename it account. I'm doing same execution. It will again insert one more account and see what is going to return. It is returning the entire account. You will see the name, the account number, the ID field, because these are the field having the valid value. Similarly, if you go and check, it has account, it is return. Got it? So return type is something, you can mention it anything based on your client and your requirement. So you may ask, Ashok, why I need all this thing? Where I'm going to use it at the back end? Exactly where this kind of code I will be using? Yes, you'll be using this kind of logic when it comes to an UI part, like a post page, or when it comes to lightning components, definitely you're going to use an Apex. For example, you will be passing an input. If you look at here, right? You're passing the input as hard code, isn't it? You're not passing the value as dynamic. Whereas if it is a UI, if you go to your UI part, even just look at this one. The script is same. If they have a Salesforce written some script, the script is same across, because whenever you click on the new, a window will pop up. Once the window is pop up, all that it will ask you the name. So the script is same, but the value you're going to given as an input is a different. Okay. So when you click on save, I think someone is on not on mute. Can you please put yourself on mute? I'm getting my voice as an echo. Okay. So whenever you click on new, and you can the same script is happening at the back end. You are giving your data, so dynamic data. The script is same, but you are giving a different input. And you click on save, it will create an account in return. Similarly, if you want to write a script that should get the dynamic data from the user, okay, let's see how we can do it. So for that, you have to pass the parameter. Let me pass the parameter. If you are going to pass the any parameter, make sure you have specify the data type for here. So here, account and account number. These are nothing but a string. Okay. So I'm giving a string, comma, string. And I give any name. So here I'm just mentioned like AC name and AC number. This is a user defined. This is an user defined. And this is a data type, because I'm going to get two input from the user, which is nothing but a string. And I'm going to use that input here. Instead of hard coding the value, I'm just putting here. And similarly, instead of hard coding the value, I'm just putting here. That's it. Now, from the user perspective, as anonymous window, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to pass the value. So OCA dot account insert. We have two parameters should be passed. So let me pass the string here. Show test params. I'm passing one string and another string. That's it. So now, if you see, I'm calling this method account insert from the class OCA, and I'm also passing the parameters. Execute. Okay, cool. Now, see, so this is how the dynamic thing is happening. So you will be writing a one piece of code, okay, and you can reuse the code for the dynamic values. So now this piece of code can be put it at anywhere, anytime. So all that what is going to change, it's going to, the code will not change anywhere. You need not to update the code every time whenever you give a new input. All that you are going to give, you're going to change only the input. If you want to change a different input, you can change and pass the code. That's it. Okay. So this is what guys Apex class is all about. So you will be writing a piece of code and you will be putting that in the into a method. So that method is going to return anything, whether it's going to return or not, or it is can be written any account or ID or string, whatever you want. Similarly, you can make that method as a dynamic one, working as a integer. You can pass any value at the runtime and that value will be processed. Since this is a very simple method, we have only four pieces of line here. But at the practical area, you won't be seeing like this, but it will be like 300 lines, 400 lines. But if you look at that 300 lines, right, the same concept only repeated, keep on repeated. All that they will be passing some value, you will be doing some operations here, and you will be returning some value. That's it. This is a core concept you should understand in the Apex. If you're able to crack down this core concept, if you have a very clear understanding in this concept, you can crack any number of lines of code on yourself. Apart from that, there are few keywords we'll be using within a Salesforce. That is something you can Google and get, okay, what is this keyword is doing? But at the end of day, this is the code. You have a code, and for that code, you will be passing some value. That using that value, you will do some process. Once you process that code, you will return some value. And the backend, you will be using that value for some purpose. That's it. This is the core for Apex class and the Apex basics. Any doubt, guys, in this one, in this piece of code and this method?
Sir, when you insert the account number, you showed me that in the front end, right? So how we can check in the back end where it's inserted and where in some database or where it's inserted?
Sorry, maybe your question is we are inserting here and we are able to see that in the front end. You want to see it in the back end itself, whether it is inserted or not. Is that your question, or in the back end itself?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Because when you execute the code, I saw that it's some SOQL is being executed.
Correct.
In the log.
Correct.
So how can I confirm whether that the account number 1234 that nine up to zero it's inserted in the back end?
Okay. See, again, we have a return type here, right? AC.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me. You can put it in the system debug. Previously, okay, no problem. So see, now I'm just going to call this method. But what I'm going to do is, it is going to return some value for me. System.debug. So let me execute this script. If you click on the debug only, see the debug only is nothing but you have many steps here, but it will. Can you just please put yourself on mute? I'm getting noisy. Okay. Parthiban, can you please put yourself on mute? Parthiban. Okay, super. So if you look at that, if you want to see only debug only, see, the account is inserted and the inserted account is name, account number, ID. All that what we have done is we just pass that function in the system.debug. System.debug is nothing but for the question you are asked, where I can see what is going on among the my script. If you have 3000 lines of code, I want to have checkpoints at every 10 lines or checkpoints at every 100 lines. You can use the system.debug and check whether your flow is coming in correct or not. It's a kind of check we can use at the backend.
Ashok, I have a similar question.
Yes.
For an error capture or error handling or something like that, is there a way I can programmatically identify? If you said, if I go for the system debug, I can see the results on the screen. if that's one record or two records. But if I have like 10 or 20 records, which is going on a loop, and I want to identify if all the records have been created. Say there is a flow or a process, I mean, there is a process builder which is inbuilt and there is some errors. Like I supplied 10 records and there was two duplicates and they were rejected. So is there a way I can identify programmatically how many was done and how many was not?
See, if you want to have a programmatic way of, for example, if you are inserting 1,000 records, okay, but out of the 1,000 records, you want to have, you want to see what and all the records inserted and what and all records got errored out. Okay.
Yeah.
If that is your question, you should have a return type like this. For example, like this, and you have to what have to do based on the return type, whether if it is this is written something, right? Your account or something. Suppose if there is nothing is written, you should again write a script for your own. Make sure if it returns, you should have a track. If it is not written, you can have a track of not getting updated. This is something you have to, again, you have to do a programmatic way of logging the your happenings. I mean, logging the logic. You can still log.
Oh, okay.
What you have to do is, again, you have to write a three lines to log the script. Apart from that, I can show you like where I can see the debug log dynamic way. If you want to check what is happening when I click the, for example, this kind of operation happen when you give an input and click on some button. Okay. Suppose when you inserting some button, you are facing some error and you are not sure why I'm getting the error. By the time, this kind of logs you cannot do, because you are able to see the logs here only when you are doing an anonymous. If you want to see the logs in the real time, what you have to do? Go to setup. Then debug. In that, debug logs. Now you can create a log for the user. You can, it means it will help you to trace what the user is doing. If even if the user is doing some configuration things also, you can track it here. You can track for user, you can track for Apex class and triggers and automated process. Let's track for myself, AJ skill development. You can have a track of maximum 24 hours. And the levels, something you can choose anything randomly. Okay, now save. This debug log, what will help you, right? For example, if I'm going here, I'm editing this account. Save the record. So this is the one operation I have done here. So at the back end, what will happen? A log will be created for all my operations. See, the log is get created. You can go to the log and see if there is anything else. This is something, suppose if you face any error or something, this detailed log will tell you what is the error, why you are facing such error and all. Because it will have every seconds and every milliseconds. If something happened, anything, right? See, even if you look at here, you are just all that you have inserted record, but what it is doing, it is taking the validation road, it is taking the duplicate detector, workflow, everything, right? So in that way, you can identify if this is kind of a production support team always do like this. Whenever they face any error in the production, they will come to the sandbox. They will replicate the error. Before they replicate, they put the debug log for the user and they will replicate the error. After they replicate, they will go into this log and see what has happened wrong, what is going wrong. Okay, this is one another way you for you to debug your logs. Okay. But coming back to your question, yes, if you want to have a track record of out of 1,000 record insert, how many inserted, how many got errored out, you can still do that, but you need to do one more line of coding. Okay. Anything else, guys? Any doubts on Apex class so far?
Sir, I don't know whether my question is correct or not. What I'm trying to understand is, sir, if for in I mean, if we are inserting something in the back end, so if you are inserting a record in a table, so we'll go into the database and we'll put a select star from this table, right? Mm-hmm. So like that, can we confirm can in
like that? See, I understood what you are trying to ask. Since you are from the DB background, you are trying to ask like whether I can directly go into the DB and check whether it's instead of I'm checking in the UI, right? Is that your question?
Yes, sir.
We can still do that. That is actually our next step. If you know anybody, nobody have any questions on this Apex class, we can go for that DB thing. Anybody have any questions on this?
Okay. No, sir.
Okay, cool. So now let's go for the questions Venkat has asked, which is something we are going to see as part of our today's class, which is search languages. Okay, so Salesforce has an inbuilt database, like other application where they will be having the websites or a web server in one technology, and they will have a database in Oracle or SQL in another technology. This is not the case in Salesforce. We have an inbuilt database. Whatever you can do is you will be directly doing the database. Like coming back to your question, Venkat, yes, you can still do here. You can use the same SQL language here, but we call it here, we call it as an SOQL, Salesforce object search language.
Query language.
Yeah, query language. Select ID and name, account number. Again, whatever you're going to use here, it is, should be a API name. Since it is an account object, okay, the API name and the name are similar. If you're going to use a custom object, that should be a underscore underscore from account.
Got it.
Execute. It will display all the data. Suppose if you want to check the particular data, because in the script we are using some, what is the name we have used here? ASGS, right?
Yes.
If you want to check whether this particular data is inset or not, put like where name equal to search it here. See, you can check it in the backend itself. I hope this answered your question, right, Venkat?
Yes, same.
Yeah. So this is a query language we are using in Salesforce. You can use this query language to query the data. You can this is something, start with select. You will mention what are the fields here. If you don't want any fields, you can remove here. By default, it will display the record. Actually, this will show, I think, 2000, maximum 2000 records at a stretch. If it is goes beyond, it will not show here. You cannot directly see the records here because it has a very limited thing. If you want to limit the data, you can add a limit tag. It will limit only 10 records. If you want to see any particular record, if you want to add a columns, I mean the field, you can add. You can add any field you want. Billing state. Suppose if you want to see only CA, add a condition of where billing state, nothing but the field name, and add the condition. That's it. Okay. So this is a query language. Okay. Query language is something you can do this query on a single object. We have one more query language called SOSL. We have two language, SOQL, SOSL. This is a Salesforce object query language, and this is Salesforce object search language. Okay. This will help you to query a piece of keyword from the multiple object. If you look at that, there is a, in this option, you can see enter SOQL or SOSL. If it is SOQL, it starts with select columns from where the type. If it is SOSL, it will start with find. Let me have a query. Okay, so find, you can have a keyword here. If it is going to use it in a within a query editor, have a braces. If you're going to use it in a script, it can be within the single quotes. If it is going to be used within the query editor, test in all fields returning, which you can mention any objects here, account, contact, object. In the previous SOQL, we searched only an account object, whereas now we are going to search this particular keyword among all the objects. See, it returns the data from three objects. Unfortunately, there is no record in the lead, so it is not coming here. If you want to add a name, I mean, add a one more column here, you can have it here. Currently, it is not here. If you want to here, you can add it. Don't keep it an ID also, you can keep. So SO, SL, SOQL, the major difference between SO, SL and SOQL, maybe people will ask you during the interview, it is nothing but SOQL helps you to select, I mean, search the data only from the single object. Whereas if it is SOSL, it helps you to search for the string or data among the multiple object. Okay, maybe, okay, that is one thing. In practical thing, where we will be using this kind of data, I can show you a real-time example. If you look at a website. So this is a website, it's a UK government website where they have their registered companies data here. If you go, this is a search bar they have developed. If you search for Barclay, a company name, is at the back end, what is happening is SOSL is happening and it is returning the data. Of course, it is returning from the method. That method is returning this data. If you go and check, you see, what is this ID all about? Any idea? This is nothing but an account ID.
Account ID.
In the Salesforce. They are using a Salesforce for them. But the UI, what you are saying is different. Okay, they are just returning the expected data. So it will return the data of Barclays. So at the back end, what is happening? Okay, so it is query for the data, a particular company called Barclays, and it will return the account data wherever it is there. So this is how, since what we are now doing is a basic class, in our advanced classes, we will see how to develop these pages and how we can bring up this data. But this will give you some output. Okay, this is where we can be used. This. Okay, this is SOSL for you guys and this is SOQL. And any doubt in this SOSL, SOQL? Because this is very straightforward. There is not nothing much you like Apex basics and all. If you want to work on SOQL and SOSL, I will give you some examples. We'll just try to play with that. How to, suppose if you want to bring only particular data, how to do that, how to add a where condition. Suppose if you want to see only records, how to do that. Okay.
Ashok, I have a quick question.
Yes.
So Ashok, when we are going into the lightning components, right? So we need to provide search in a way such that, like, let's say if you're searching for TEST, so if we press the button as T, we should be getting the results as T, and then if we press another letter like TE, so we'll be getting like the search. I mean, the search should be dynamic, right? In the lightning components. So for that, it will be the same query, or do we need to alter anything to it? Like TE, TE,
yeah, if you look at liquid test, you say, suppose I want to put like a dynamic value, because even if you look at the website, they are doing a dynamic, they're not doing a same query, because I searched for Barclay. If you want to search for, even if you, there should be some data.
Yes. No, okay.
It will return some value, right? So if you search for some other.
Ashok, I think he means search as you type kind of, like when you type Barclays, when you start BA, it should show Barclays or base.
Oh, BA kind of result.
Company name is there.
I think so. It's like parameter we need to use. That's what he's questioning.
No, no. Whether you want to have a, see, you want like something in the Google, how it is displayed.
Right.
Like if you, once you start typing, it is coming right. Okay.
Right, yes.
So you want to display like, this is something you have to do right. with Lightning components here. Nothing we yes. cannot do with the backend. What we are seeing now is absolute backend. Okay. So okay. this is something you have to write a JavaScript, something that should pull up this kind of, what to say, the recently used keywords or these things. This is, of course, it needs a lot of coding. Yeah, this is possible in Salesforce. That is something, it is possible. But again, you need to do some further steps. Of course, we will be seeing all these things in our upcoming classes. But today class is all about, I don't want to give you a mass look about Salesforce, especially when it comes to coding. I just want to give you the very basic touch, what and all in the Salesforce and how this can be used so that you will start prepare your mind for the script, because it is always there when it comes to the people, they will have a little bit of fear about the scripting and all, right? This is something, this class is all about breaking that fear, because we are going to show you there is nothing you have to fear about the coding. It is very, very simple as it is. But all that, what you have to understand is you should have a strong basic knowledge. That's it. You can have this data as a dynamic. That is also possible.
And one more question, Ashok. So we are returning account ID, comma name, contact ID, comma name, right? And opportunity, we are not using the ID, comma name for opportunity as well.
You can use, if you want, you can put.
Okay. Okay, we just ignored it. Okay, okay.
Even if you want to put one more name, you can put
the parameter.
Keep on adding it. So that's what I will give you the case studies. Yeah, don't worry, for all the things, Apex, Max, Apex, and all other things, I will be giving the case studies. That case study will give you the idea of how to do that, what and all that can be do. It will help you to explore many things within the SOQL, Apex, SOS. See, that is the what the future of AJ skill development. We are just not going to give you how to do and what not to do. We'll give you the plenty of real-time case studies. It is your thing that you have to, after this class, after your understanding, after even I will be giving you the recorded video session, you can keep it as for your reference. You should work on the case studies. While work on the case studies, you will be Googling also for many things. That will give you another learning. Actually, the real learning is you will do only when you put your hands dirt, especially for doing this thing. Okay. Don't worry, I will give you plenty of case studies for SOSL, SOQL. You will learn a lot. Okay. Fine. Okay, anything else, guys, in SOSL and SOQL? Okay. So just please put yourself on mute if anybody have no questions. Any questions? Okay. Manoj, please put yourself on mute. Okay, thank you. I think somebody is still Manoj. Okay, I put him on, no problem. Fine. Okay, let's move on to the collections. So what we have seen so far is basics of Apex and this SOQL and SOSL. Now the collections. If you look to the collections, okay. Collections, oh. Okay. We have seen everything. Now it's all about collections. In a Salesforce, we have a list, set, and map. These are our collections we are going to see. First of all, what is collection? As the name itself, it is defining it, that collection is nothing but the collections of the records. See, of course, as an end of day, we are not going to deal with any single update, single insert, or a single thing. Whatever we are going, because we are going to work for an enterprise. In that enterprise, we are going to always deal with the bulk thing, right? So in order to do the bulk update, bulk insert, or bulk retrievation, we need a collections. Okay, fine. Let's see how the collection it is and how it will help you to do that. Because go to developer console. Okay, here first we'll see how the list is works. List is something you can define like list, then within the phrase you have to mention the API name of an object. For example, if you're going to get the list of records of account, you have to mention it as an account. Suppose if you're going to deal with the list of contact, you have to mention it as a contact. So it is always the object. Okay, so mention that object here and give some name. The name can be anything. Account list, ACC list, AC list. This is something in user defined, even if you can give any random name. But to make some sense, let me go AC list, new list of account. That's it. So what is list? First of all, list will help you to get the collections of records. Okay. So if you look at here, right? Let's go to some SQL query. Select ID, come on name, come on account number, come on account. Okay, execute. This is gives the entire account, almost 34 account. If you want to have this account as a temporary data, you can put that in the within the list. It's a list equal to put your query within the brace. That's it. So what will happen now? Now you are taking the copy of all the data and you have put that in this list as a collection. You can check it as right away. You can put like system.debug. See, the entire record is now within this list. If you look at the debug statement, you can see the ACC list. The ACC list have all the accounts that is displaying it. Since the debug will have only limited characters, we're not able to see the entire account here. It shows only the first few accounts. So as I mentioned earlier, list is nothing but it will have the temporary memory locator, or you can call it as a temporary area where you can have the copy of the record from the DB and you can put it here. Okay, why we need to take the copy of the DB and we need to put it in the list? What I'm going to do with that? If that is your question, yes, I will answer you. That if you want to do I think Rajesh is, yes, if you want to do the bulk operations, I think Venkat also asked one good question. What if I'm going to do with the bulk operations? If it is not a one or two records, that case you will go for a list. If you look at the scripts, what we have seen so far is this is an insert, inserting the data into the database. And if you look at this SQL, this is something like retrieving the data from the database. Now, what we are going to see is update the data. So first you will retrieve the particular data from the database. Then you do some modification on the existing database and push that data into the database. Let's see how we can do that. So I have a list here, which is something having the list of account. Let me add one more column here, billing state. Okay, fine. So now my requirement, it is something like billing state. I have many billing state here. Okay, CA, UK, anything. Suppose my requirement here is I want to change all my CA billing state into FL. So what and all CA here? What and all CA here? If I want to change all the CA into FL, let's see how we can do it. So first, to do that, I took that all the data within a temporary memory locator that is nothing but my list. Okay, now what I'm going to do is, since I need to do the changes in all the three objects, I cannot directly go into the each object and edit, right? So in order to do that, I'm getting the help of for loop. So for loop, what it will do, it will, for loop is, as name mentioned, it is a loop. It will go one by one record and will help you to update the each record. So in order to do the for loop, so it tells me what is this at all? What records, what are these records? Which object?
Account.
Account, right? So we are going to traverse across the account object. So mention as account. Again, API. Wherever you're going to use, because if it is going to be a custom object, mention the custom object API name here. Account. So, and I'm going to give an instance. Instance nothing but, suppose if it is a 10 records, if it is going to check for the very first record will represent AC. Then if it comes to the second record, AC represents the second record. Okay, this is an instance. Then have a colon. Okay, as a syntax. Then I'm mentioning the list here. It means I'm going to traverse across the account object, and this is the instance. This instance will traverse across the list. This is not going directly traverse in the database. I have a list where I have the list of account with me in the temporary locator. I'm going to traverse across the list. Okay. For example, when the loops is working, first, this AC goes for the first record, then the second record, then the third record. It will keep on going till the last record. This is how the for loop works. Any questions on this? Because this is a crucial area, people usually will get confused. That's why I'm just repeating. We have a for loop. Why we are going to need a for loop is because I'm going to do some operation on the entire collection. I'm not going to do operation for a single record. I'm going to do an operation in an entire collection. In order to do that in an entire collection, I need to do one by one. If I need to do one by one, I need a for loop. If it is a for loop, I need to mention on which object I'm going to do this thing. And then after the colon, I have mentioned across what are the collection I'm going to do that. Okay. Any questions so far? Good. So now, my condition is I have to do some operation. What is the operation I'm going to do is I have to change the billing state into FL, Florida. But not for all the billing state. I have to do only for CA. So I put the condition if AC dot billing state equal to CA. So as I mentioned, AC represent the very first record. For example, if it is a CA record, Okay, if it is a billing status CA, first you'll go to this record and check whether this record is CA or not. If it is CA, it will do the operation. If it is not CA, it will ignore it. Okay. If AC.billingState is equal to CA, then I will change that into AC.billingState equal to FL. So only if it is satisfy my condition, it will change the billing state. Otherwise, it will not change. That's it. Okay. Any doubt why I'm doing this? My condition is, if it is a CA record, I have to change it as an FL record. So first I go and check the very first record. If it is CA, it will change the FL. Otherwise, it will ignore. Again, the loop will continue. It will go and check the second record, third record, fourth record. So whenever the condition satisfies, if it is CA, then it will change it to FL. Okay, cool. Fine. Now, once you say changed it, right, you have to put it in another collection. I need another list. Why I need another list is because I'm changing the record, isn't it? I'm actually, if it is a CAA, I need another collection where if I'm changing anything, I need to put that. Billing state equal to FL. I cannot directly go ahead and edit in the same collection. Why? Because this collection is already iterating. I should not disturb this collection. So I need one more collection so that I can keep the copy of this data. So for that, what I will do, I will create one more collection called
new
update list. Okay. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to add the updated record in the update list. Add AC. Okay. So if I'm making a change, if AC dot billings, let me put it here. It will make some sense. So first I'm checking the very first record. If it is a CA, I will changing it as FL. If I'm changing it as an FL, what I will do, I will put it in the separate collection. Second it comes, it is CA, it ignore. Third it comes, CA, ignore. The fourth it comes, it's C, it is a CA record. So it will go and update the billing state and I will put that in the separate collection. Okay, at the back end it will happen. So now what I have a new collection of a record with the updated FL record. I should come out of the for loop and have a keyword update, then put this list. So far what I'm doing is till here, till the line number 14, what I'm doing is I'm just playing with my collections, with my copy from the database. I had to commit the changes, what and all I have done here to the database. In order to commit the data, in order to commit the changes to the database, you should have the keyword, either insert or update or delete. In our case, I'm not going to insert any new record. I'm going to update the existing record. So update, what I'm going to update? I'm going to update this collection, okay? Even if you want to have a debug statements, you can have it. What is coming in the update? If you want to put like the debug. Okay, let execute it. Condition expression must be a type of Boolean or string. Okay. If it is. Expression line number 10, what is happening? Should be a single one.
Probably this must be single, yeah.
Yeah, this should be a single. Let's see what else we are missing here. billing state, we have given name, account number, everything is given.
On line number 8, I think we need to give like double equal to.
Line number 8.
Yeah.
No, actually.
We are checking if condition, right?
We're checking only the if condition. It should allow here. Let's see. Condition expression must be a type Boolean. String.
Yeah, it's right. Line 7, we need double equal sign.
Yes. See what is happening, the DML exception, update file, enter the value greater. So see here, do you have any idea what it is and what it is saying? Any guess?
Some validation rule being executed.
Exactly. So as I mentioned earlier, whenever you do some DML operation, insert or update or delete, what has happened? It goes order of by go by the order of precedence. I'm doing update here, so it goes by the order of precedence. And what is happening? It is not. I'm update trying to update a record. I see there are some record which is maybe out of this record CACA, not satisfying this validation rule. Maybe we have created the record before we create the validation rule. That's the reason it accepted the data. Now let's go and turn off that validation rule, because we don't need that now. Go to the validation rule. If you guys remember, those who attend admin class, this is something we have demonstrated for validation. So let me turn it off, save it. Now go and execute. Okay, it is executed. If you check the debug only, you see the list of list get added. What are the list? Now, if you query for CA record, this is the old data, let's close it. If you query for the CA record, nothing will be there. Why? Because we have updated all the record as FL. If you won't check the FL, it will be there. That's it. Just to have a quick look at the code and let me know if you have any questions on this, because this is a very basic for the collections.
Ashok.
Yes.
Just to list and get the list from the account, and then we're validating the billing states here. Why we cannot directly get the records
do.
Only for?
You can do. You can directly put a where condition here as.
Okay.
Where billing state? I just want to give an idea about if condition and for condition.
Okay.
Ashok, like normally when we handle arrays, is it possible to get the number of records in this collection?
Number of records, yes, you can get. You can get like if you put that.
Now, before updating, when the collection is created, is there a possibility I can check if there is 1,000 records, I need to work on only 100 records. Is there something option like that?
If you want to have that in the script itself, you can do. Otherwise, you can check it in the query editor itself. Like I will show you how you
can. Not in the query editor, in the script, I mean. Within the for loop, before I start the for loop, if I want to know how many records are there,
Yeah, you can do that. That is something list size. Dot size of. Suppose if you want to, because we don't need this. Okay. Let's see how the size of it works. See, this will give the size.
Yeah, perfect. Okay.
Okay. Anything else, guys? Okay. See, if you look at this, suppose if I ask you to make it as a dynamic, how you will do? Dynamic in sense, here I'm checking for CA and replacing at FL. Okay. Suppose if I ask you to check for FL and I will ask you to rename to some AY or AZ, how you will do?
When we create that list within the braces, we can put the parameter names.
Correct.
The first line when we declare it.
Yes, exactly. So what you have to do is you have to put this entire logic within a method. So within a method, you pass these two parameters, CA and FL, or it can be FL or CA, and you can pass the value dynamically. This is something you can take it as your homework or something. So you can try it on your own. Okay. So and let me know whether you are getting a correct answers or not, because this is something you can work on that. Because always we are not going to do this kind of stuff within an anonymous window itself. Whatever the script you are going to write is all about your writing within the Apex class. Okay, so you go try it on your own and let me know. Fine. So this is all about the list, guys. You will be getting the collections here, and there are plenty of things you can play around with the list. After the end of this sessions, I'll be sharing the links for the collections and SQL, SOSL. You can have a look. Then come back to the set. Actually, I'm not going to explain you much on the set because list and set are very similar. There is no, there are a few cases, but when you look at the operation, syntax and all, it is very similar. All that you will be replacing the word list as set. That's it, nothing else. But the main difference between the list and the set is, list is an ordered collection, whereas set is an unordered collection. If I say ordered means, if you have list of 34, like if you see, if we have 34
values. Ashok, I think we have reversed it. I think set is an ordered collection.
Sorry. Is that reversed?
Yeah. List is an unordered collection, I think so.
Let me look. Take a look. See, it's actually confusing. Collections. I think I'm right.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So that's what I will be giving you all this link. Maybe this will give you the very deeper understanding. But what I'm going to explain is all about basic. So why I'm saying it is an order and unordered. In list, you can see we have 34 records here, right? Suppose if you want to get a debug of, let's see. If I want to get the second record or third record in the list, you can get like this. You can pass it in an array. If you want to get the third record, you can get it here. See, if you look at the third record, it will come. You can specify which number you want and you can get the exact record you want. Whereas in set, you cannot put like this. You cannot put like this and I cannot expect the same third record will return because it is an unordered collection. If it is a list, it will go like a stack. It will go get added the record one by one, one by one, one by one. But where is a list, it will go like a random condition. You cannot retrieve the data by passing a set of zero, set of one. Okay, that is one thing. The second thing is in list, you can have a duplicate of record. Whereas in set, no duplicate. If I say no duplicate means, for example, if you are trying to add a same ID again and again, it will get added in the list. But if it is a set, it will not allow. Maybe it will have the last added thing. Suppose you want to have a, if you set is something you can use where you want, you don't want any duplicates in the collections. So that's the main difference between the list and set. Okay, you can have a take a look at set in this link. I will share you. Rest of the things are similar as it as list, adding, removing, and all. Now let's go to the map. So map is also one kind of collection we use in Salesforce, but in map we have a special feature called key and key values. This is also going to be a collection, but we will be having the collection in terms of key and key value. Let's see how it is. Suppose, okay, let me use this. Let me define a map here, list. Before that, let me give you a very brief example. Then we will use the S objects. I'm creating a map. As I mentioned, map can be a key and key value. That keys and key values can be any data type, comma, ID, comma, ID, string, comma, string, even ID, comma, string, integer, comma, string. It can be anything. Let me put like integer, comma, string, color map equal to map. String. Okay, fine. Suppose if you want to insert the data into the map, put like color map dot put. Use the keyword put and you can insert the data. So let me put one comma. All right. Similarly, if I want to put like 2, 3, blue. Okay, so what I'm doing is I'm just created a map and I'm just keep on putting the values. If you want to see what is the value in the map, again system.debug, just have the debug about the map. Okay, but now if you execute, something is missing. What is missing?
A new map of.
Okay. Okay, fine. See? We see key value. Suppose if you want to retry any particular data, you can mention it like dot get of. If you pass the key, it will retry the key value. If I'm passing line 2, it will retry me the blue. Similarly, if you pass another any other number, it will retry the same. Okay. Actually, let me put all this script, otherwise we'll keep an error. Let me put the scripts here. Maybe you can use it for your purpose. Fine. Any other script we have used? Now, okay, this is how the map is. All that you have to declare the map key and key value, and you will put the value like this and you will get the value like this. Let's see how this is something we can use it, make use of it for Salesforce objects. Okay, let me put the map. So you have the list already, which is something, a list of accounts. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put that list within the account, within a map. So we have a map here. So let me create a new map, a map of, as I mentioned, it can be key and key value of any combination, ID, comma, account. So in my case, the ID will work as a key and account will work as a key values. AC map, new map of ID, comma, account. Okay, good. So now let's add the value into the map. So I need a key. So dot put AC dot ID. AC represent here this account, which is go with this collection. AC ID, comma, AC is nothing but the account. I will put AC. Now, if you have a system debug of AC map, execute it. See, we have the map here. Just take the map and let's see what is happening. If you look at the debug, we have AC map here. And see how the map is get mapped. You have a key and the key values. And you have the key and the key values. You have the key values, key and key values. This how, this here it is a key, and this is the key values, the entire account. And here ID is the key, and we have an entire account as the key value. Suppose if you want to retry, for example, this particular name, this particular account name, if you want to retry, you pass this key. Let's see how we can do that. If I want to get the account name of this particular ID, put get and pass the account ID. Okay, if you pass the account ID, first it will retry the entire account. First we see, execute. See here now, this is an account for that particular piece of ID. Okay, suppose if you want to get only the name, you just have like dot name. See? It retries only the name, that is the name of the account, test process. Okay, so this is what map, guys. Map is nothing but you can have the data as key and key values. You can add the values into the map. If you want to add the collections of data, this is how you have to put it within the for loop of the collection. Add the value. If you want to retry the map data, put like get and get the name. Okay, similarly using map, you can have many functions are there, map methods. That is something, if you look at the scripts, any Apex script, it will have the thousands of list, map and all. Again, it will keep on repeating the same for loop, if loop, collections, list and all. It will only keep on repeating, nothing else more. And maybe there's some keywords, if you, maybe we can have map methods, When you get time, just go ahead with this Apex guide, especially the map Apex guide. It will give you some methods in maps that will help you to understand. There are methods like contains, let's go with contains. You see, the contains return true if the map contains a mapping of the specified key. Okay, let's see how it works. Let me have a, since the contain is going to return true or false, contains and the key. Okay, AC map dot contains key. We are going to check whether this particular key is available or not within a map. Let's see. It is written as true. Suppose if you're passing any non-available key, I'm just changing the key and execute. If it is not available, it will return as false. So similarly, you can make use of all the map methods and functions. And one more important thing about map is the key value right here. Whatever you specify here, the key value is become a unique. If you want to, if you try to add any duplicate key value, it will not allow. It will take the recent added key. Sorry, I mentioned as key value, it is key. Suppose if you keep on adding the same ID again and again, it will have the recent added ID only. It will ignore the last part. For example, if you look at here, I'll show you how it works. We have map integer here, right? Suppose if I am trying to add the same key value of 1, but mention this as cm. I'm already adding 1, 2, 3, then again I'm adding a 1. Let's see what is we are getting in the 1. See, we are getting CN. We will not get the red because the map will not allow the duplicate key and it will have the recent added key. Okay, all right. So, let's go. Hey guys, I have plenty of case studies. So what you have to do is you have to, based on today's class, you will be working on these case studies. And in the next class or whenever you are free, you can share me the scripts you have developed so that I can review that and will tell you what is wrong with that and what is true and what is not to do. This will give you the very good understanding of Apex Basic, as well as I have interview questions also with the Apex Basics. What and all the possible interview questions they can ask if you with the Apex. It's all about only the basic. We don't have went to the very advanced level. I'll be sharing that to you. Okay. Any questions so far from the Apex, collections, SOQL, list, set, map? Any questions?
No, sure. I'm good.
This might be an advanced question. Just a quick one. When we click on new and we get a form like stuff, right? On Lightning. So this kind of Apex coding is what drives that form, right?
Technically not, because that is something inbuilt Salesforce. Okay. But if you want to have a like that one, you can create.
We can create something. Apex. Okay. Okay.
Also, still it is a myth or mystery unsolved that what is Salesforce doing at the back end to do all this stuff.
Okay.
So it is
those inbuilt ones we cannot edit in, right?
That's you cannot do because that's a standard functionality. You cannot edit that, but you can create a like that one for yourself. Even you can make a modification.
Okay. So with Apex, we can create a fresh GUI form and we can put all the controls in it. Everything can be done.
Apex is something will not help you for GUI. Apex is for the backend, the logic. For GUI, we go for Visual Force page, Lightning components.
Okay. So with the Lightning components, we'll create that form and we'll put the Apex code behind it to work.
Yeah, you can.
Okay. Okay. So Apex is going to be like more like a VBA, which works only on Excel or Word.
Yeah,
it doesn't create a GUI separately mostly.
It's a logic with which will drive the UI. Which should
okay.
be input and what should we do with the received input?
Okay.
Okay. That's good. We have still 8 participants who are patiently listening all these things and asking questions. Good. Fine, guys. Any doubt among you 8? John, Parthiban, Priya, Rajesh, Ramesh, Sasi, Venkat?
No, Shakul. We try the case tradition.
Have a try and then we'll come back, Ashok.
All right, guys. I will be sharing the recorded video session and we'll share you the link. And also, I will share you the case for you to work on. Have it as a reference and work on the case studies and let me know if you find any difficulty. I will be available in the WhatsApp. All right?
Okay.
Sure, Ashok. Sure.
Okay. I will let you know about the tomorrow we will have a class on Lightning components. The class will be taken by Sabrish. Okay. He will be sharing the link. Hopefully, in the same link you can join. I will let you know. Probably time might be different. That is 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. IST.
Okay.
Thank you all for this class. Have a good day. See you all tomorrow. Bye.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.